Hey, what's up, everybody, and welcome to the College Info Geek Podcast. My name is Thomas Frank, and this is a show that helps you become a more effective student. And in this episode, we are covering a topic that I have only touched on occasionally over the course of this podcast, but I know a lot of you guys are really interested in. So today, we're talking about how to study abroad. And my guest on today's episode is Ransom Patterson, who is actually my student writer. So if you've been reading the blog, all the blog posts that are not videos or podcast episodes lately have been written by Ransom. And he's an absolutely fantastic writer, and he actually pitched this idea to me as a blog post. And I thought that it would be a really good podcast episode, actually, because he is currently studying abroad at Queen's University in Belfast, Northern Ireland. So you'll get a little bit of his perspective and experience studying there, but you also get a general overview of how to pick your study abroad location and program, and also how to stay organized while applying and keep all your deadlines written down, your ducks in a row. We'll also talk about how to save on some of the hidden costs that come along with studying abroad, and talk a bit about how studying abroad can actually be cheaper than just attending a normal semester at your current university in some cases. So that is what's in store for this episode. And as always, we have show notes with links to all the resources we mentioned. So if you want to find those, head over to cigpodcast.com and click the episode 101 link on the page. And you'll find all those links along with ways to rate and review the podcast on iTunes if you would like to support the show, which I highly appreciate it if you do that. Anyway, that's all I've got for this intro. So let's get right into this interview with Ransom and learn how to study abroad. Ransom, welcome to the show, man.
Awesome. It's great to be here.
Yeah, dude. So we tried to record this last week, and our internet just completely died on us. We're going to talk about studying abroad today, but the day we recorded it last week was the day after St. Paddy's Day. And since you're studying abroad in Ireland, I'm still curious about what it's like over there on St. Paddy's Day. Are you in Dublin, or where are you at, actually?
To be very clear, I'm in Belfast, which is in Northern Ireland, and people here will get very irritated. Well, some people will get very irritated if you confuse the two, because it's not...
Oh, you're in Northern Ireland.
Yeah.
So you're actually in the UK. Okay.
Although even that is a bit contentious. It's a very complicated...
I'll just link to CGP Grey's UK video.
Yes, that would be perfect, actually. That will work, because you're not the only one. Actually, most people back home are like, Belfast, where is that, you know?
I do a lot of Google Maps, just, you know, random Google Maps scrolling. Mm-hmm. But I didn't know where Belfast was. I just do like random street view drops sometimes, because I'm curious.
I was gonna say, have you ever played that game? I think there's
you know, GeoGuessr.
Yeah, that's what it is. Yeah,
I actually did a live stream with some friends of mine from the UK. Simon, I think his last name's Clark. Yeah.
Who does, yeah, okay.
So I did Simon Clark and then Sally LePage, and one of the guy who was able to be in there for like 5 minutes, again due to Google Hangouts complications. But we did GeoGuessr, and we did pretty darn good, actually.
Were they like better at it than you, or did it just sort of depend?
I think it was really a team effort, but like every single time it just dropped us into complete barren wastelands. I was like, you're not throwing me a bone at all here. No cities. It was like, oh, look, random abandoned dirt road in the middle of nowhere with a tree. And we're like, Sally, you're a scientist. Can you identify the leaves on that tree? Nope, they're too blurry. So our only hope is to go try to find like a truck and identify the language on it or something.
Yeah, if you can find any signs, that does tend to help.
But yeah, dude, I was just dropping the little street view man into random places in Ireland and Scotland. And oh my gosh, it's freaking gorgeous over there.
Oh, it's so beautiful. It's just, you're just like, wow. So this is like where they shot. Well, because you know, like Game of Thrones is filmed, a lot of it in Northern Ireland.
Really?
Yeah, actually, in Belfast, the studio, like where they film, I guess, the non-location stuff, that's actually here.
That's awesome.
Which is not, I'm not like, I've actually watched the show, but I know a lot of people, you know, it's to the degree that they have like a Game of Thrones tour, because there's not a ton of tourism in Belfast historically, but they're trying now, you know, because it's like a huge industry in the Republic of Ireland.
Yeah.
So, and one of the things they found they can do is, Game of Thrones tourism.
That makes sense. I am finally caught up with Game of Thrones.
Oh, okay. I've never seen any of it. I know. I mean, I get like the basic references just because, you know, they're everywhere, but.
Mm-hmm. It's a fantastic show. I was kind of against watching it for a while, because my perception was it's one of those shows like Breaking Bad or Hell's, or what do they call it? The one with the bikers. I don't even remember that one. Sons of Anarchy. Oh, where nothing but like bad stuff ever happens. And that's very true in Breaking Bad and Sons of Anarchy. Like, nothing good ever happens in those shows. And I was like, well, Game of Thrones is probably going to be one of those shows where it's always depressing, and I don't want to watch that. But my girlfriend hounded me enough that we finally sat down and watched it. And it's actually not the case. I mean, bad stuff does happen, but it's a fantastic show. And when I was in New York getting ready to speak in Vermont, we finished season 5 over 3 days.
Oh, wow. Okay. No, so. I mean, that's kind of my thing. It's like, that's sort of why, with a lot of shows too, honestly, it's like, I don't watch it because I know it would be so good and that it would just be so engrossing that I wouldn't do anything else.
Yeah. So I'm on Google Maps right now looking at Belfast. I'm looking at Belfast Castle. Are you close to that?
No, I've been there though.
Have you been
actually? Well, the castle, to be honest, is not that great, but behind it is, it's called the Cave Hill.
Okay.
And that's an awesome, beautiful hike. If you're here, you have to do the hike. It's like about an hour and a half up. And then you have this amazing view of Belfast and the harbor and a couple of the other cities around it too.
Oh, that's awesome. Actually,
if you look on Facebook, I have some pictures, I think.
I will have to look at those later. Yeah, I was looking. Oh, dude, I was also looking at Austria. I didn't realize how mountainous and just ridiculously gorgeous that country is. So now I need to visit there as well.
Well, you know, I'm going there actually.
Are you? Oh, yeah. So you're doing? Are you going to do like one of those things where it's a study abroad student takes a couple weeks to just travel Europe, that kind of thing?
1 week, but yes.
Okay. Oh, it's so cool, man.
We can get to that, I guess.
Yeah, we should probably get into the actual meat of the topic, because I'm sure like you're just here like bragging about being in Ireland, and everyone's like, how do I go?
Yes, yeah.
So
go
ahead.
The St. Patty's Day thing, we never actually addressed.
That's though. Right, yes.
I will say. Okay, so to be honest, I didn't really do much on the actual St. Patrick's Day itself, but the day before, I did go out with some people, the night before, I should say.
Mm-hmm.
And it's sort of an interesting thing again here in the North, because for the most part, people are like, oh, it's a holiday. It's an excuse to drink. We love it. You know, but there are a few people for whom it is a little, they don't like its association with the Republic of Ireland. Again, that's really complicated political stuff that I'm going to try to explain, and is a bit, for the most part now, not a huge issue, but still historically there's some weird things. So what one of my professors was saying, at least, is like, you know, until a few years ago, there wasn't even like a St. Patrick's Day parade in Belfast. That's like a pretty new thing.
Really?
But from all I can tell, it's clearly, you know, widely accepted now, at least by university students.
Mm-hmm.
You know, a lot. It's like a lot of the stereotypes are true. I mean, everyone here does wear green, although they don't have that thing about pinching people. That seems to be a U.S. thing, actually.
Thank goodness.
Because people were asking me, they're like, is it true in the U.S. that you pinch each other on St. Patrick's Day? And I was like, you don't do that here? They're like, no.
I think high school students pinch each other. I don't think I've been pinched in quite a few years, thankfully.
Yeah, but I definitely remember in high school.
I would purposely wear green. You know,
my high school mascot was the Irish, too, actually.
Oh, was it?
Yeah. So that was, it was even more of a thing, I guess. But yeah, anyway.
We had an Irish mascot, not us, but in my district, there was an Irish mascot somewhere.
Well, see, it used to be the Fighting Irish, but then Notre Dame sent us this cease and desist. Our mascot looked exactly like theirs. So now it's just the Irish.
I have seen some high schools that just like straight up have like NFL football team names as their names, or like the same logo or something.
Oh my gosh.
It's pretty funny.
But yeah, I mean, a lot of the traditions are this, I guess, kind of the same, you know. I mean, just the general celebratory atmosphere, you know, wearing green and all that great stuff. Ireland is amazing.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's all there, basically. So I don't have any, like, super exciting stories about it, I guess, actually, but it is
just
observed.
A fun night going out.
Yeah, just a fun night. Actually, it was with one of the cool clubs that I was able to join here. We can talk about that.
Oh, yeah, that'd be cool.
It was with the Caving Club.
You guys have a caving club? I wish I had caves.
Queens has a caving club. Well,
oh, my gosh.
You see, it's funny because Tennessee, you know, I'm from, actually has a ton of caves. Like,
yeah,
amazing.
I've heard about that.
But I don't know that any of the universities there have caving clubs. I could be very wrong, but just based on, I have a lot of friends that go to like the state universities in Tennessee, and I've never heard of any caving clubs. And I think Nashville might have one, but it doesn't seem to be super active. But yeah, here at Queens University, that's where I am, we should say, which is essentially the only major university in Northern Ireland and in Belfast. There are a couple other small ones and don't want to disregard them, but you know, compared to the Republic of Ireland, which has like, you know, a bunch more.
Yeah.
I, just in Dublin, there's like, you know, four of them, I think.
Republic of Ireland is quite a bit bigger, isn't it?
Yeah. Well, I mean, yeah, it's all relative, but yes. It's like you talk to, because people here are like, oh, what's the population of Nashville? I'm like, well, the greater metro area is like 1 million people. And they're like, that's like a fifth of the population of Ireland right there.
Okay. So it's a very small geographically country. It's bigger, but
yeah, but population-wise, I mean, it is bigger population-wise in the north too, but like, I mean, it's all relative. It's still all very, like, you can drive across the country like horizontally in a few hours.
Oh, okay.
Really, what is it? Someone told me, like, they gave me a comparison. I think the Northern Ireland is like about the size of Connecticut, if that helps.
Okay. Yeah, I'm looking at it right now just to try to compare.
I'm sure you can find one of those websites that will, like, do you know If It Were My Home? Have you ever seen that site?
No, but I'm going to write that down now.
Ooh, you need to, this is a cool site. We can put that in the links too. It's just fun. It's like you type in your country and then you can compare your country to any other country on earth.
That's cool.
Like different statistics, like, you know, cost of living, incarceration rates, just general happiness and a bunch of other stuff. But it also will like overlay the outline of the other country onto your country or vice versa, so you can see like the relative size.
Okay. Yeah, I'm looking at them right now. It looks like Northern Ireland is a little bit bigger than Connecticut, but yeah, pretty similar sizes.
That's the one I've heard, at least. Yeah, and then the Republic, I don't remember. There's a state for it too. I can't remember. Maybe North Carolina? I'm not sure.
Okay.
But
I was thinking North Carolina. I was going to ask you, since you're from Tennessee, have you ever been to Asheville?
No. I've been through North Carolina because I consider going to a college there. So my dad and I drove out there to see it. Mm-hmm. And we were near, I think we were near Asheville, and maybe we drove through it, but I've seen it, I guess, but I didn't do anything there. It was just sort of on the way.
Okay. I've been hearing just things that Asheville's an awesome town, and I've only ever been to Charlotte in North Carolina.
Okay.
Have you ever been to Ruby Falls Cave?
Oh, Ruby Falls. Oh, yes.
Is that in Tennessee?
Oh, my God. Yes. So I don't know if you've ever driven through Tennessee or mm-hmm. Georgia or any of the surrounding states.
That's
really
where we went, because we took a road trip from Iowa to Disney World.
Oh, you did? You did Ruby Falls. Okay. Uh-huh.
Yeah, we need something fun to break it up.
You probably saw like the hundreds of billboards advertising Sea Rock City.
Yes, whatever. We did.
Yes. Well, yeah, we went there actually on a field trip. I think it was in like sixth grade maybe or something. I don't know why. I mean, it's not like it was educational at all, except that I guess...
Hey, there's rocks.
I mean, I guess you could argue that there was a bit of geography involved. They see all those states, but I mean,
there's some geology. There.
It's not really... Well, of course, and you've read American Gods, right?
Yeah.
So I thought that was so hilarious. Had you been there when you read American Gods or not?
I'm trying to think. I'm pretty sure I went there before American Gods, yeah. Because I read American Gods when I was at the first Camp Nerd Fitness.
Okay.
Which I think was in 2014, and we went to Disney World in 2013. So I had never heard of Ruby Falls before. At the time that I was there. But then when I read American Gods, I was like, oh, I've been here. And also, fun story about American Gods. One of the settings in American Gods is this place called House on the Rock, which is this crazy roadside attraction in Wisconsin. And I read the book, and it sounded so insane that I went there. Mm-hmm. And it's the weirdest place I've ever been in my entire life.
I think I saw pictures on Facebook. I feel like I saw them.
I do have pictures. Yes. I will link to the album with the pictures. It is insane. Just, I don't know. Imagine like that some dude buying every weird thing he could ever find and just putting it in one big building. Well, it's several big buildings.
Sure.
It's like Alice in Wonderland. That's the closest thing I can equate to it.
Okay.
So anyway, studying abroad.
Studying abroad, yes.
Now that I know a little bit about St. Paddy's Day, I wanted to ask you, because I did not study abroad as a student. The only thing I did as a student is after my junior year ended, I went to Japan for a couple weeks because my friend Ryan had posted on Facebook that he was going, and I jokingly said, yeah, I'll come with you, bro. And then he said, for real? Because I want someone to go with. So I went, but with studying abroad, there was always like this kind of hesitation and fear in my mind. Like, I don't know. I always kind of wanted to do it, but there was also mm-hmm. this I don't want to leave my friends for an entire semester. And I was kind of like worried it would tack on more debt. And I knew that if I looked into it, I might be able to find scholarship opportunities and find ways to kind of rationalize all those fears. But I just never pursued it. So you're doing it right now. And I got all the opportunities to ask you the questions. So, I mean, was studying abroad something you wanted to do, like, right when you went into college? Was it always a desire of yours?
Yeah, it was always a desire of mine. I mean, it was like, because I guess part of it is my parents, you know, when they went to college, they had studied abroad. So they always talked about it. You know, that was sort of their, like, world travel experiences or whatever they would bring in. And even my grandma actually had lived back in, like, in the 50s or late 40s. She lived in Germany for a couple of years, not to study, but she was working for the Air Force, actually.
Oh, cool.
As a radio operator. So she got to go over there. They paid for it, you know, basically. They're like, okay, if you work for us for 2 years, we'll pay for you to go over there and to live and, you know, whatnot. And actually, that's where she met my grandfather. So that was lucky. Cool. But yeah, so I guess I'd always heard stories about, you know, especially sort of European travel. And then the college I attend, they definitely push it too. I mean, it's not unique to mine. I think a lot of, I don't know about your university, but, like, at least, you know, a lot of the ones I toured, which granted were, I guess, sort of smaller ones, that was always a big selling point for them, was, oh, you can study abroad here and still graduate on time and all that stuff, you know, which
is definitely a big thing in Iowa State too.
True. It really isn't true for some majors, but for English and other humanities sort of majors, it's usually true.
Well, I've heard it's, I mean, we'll probably get into this a little bit, but I've heard it's, it definitely depends, because if you study abroad later in your student career, then you run into problems where the university abroad may wait like an entire semester to send your grades from the program. So then you can't graduate until, like, this university in Ireland sends over your grades. So at least in my school, they were like, you should probably study abroad junior year or earlier. Don't do it your senior year.
Yeah, for us, you really can't study abroad your senior year just because of the way our system works. Like, because our big thing at Worcester is you do, it's called a senior independent study, or IS we call it, which is like a year-long research sort of thesis type paper. You know, it's almost like a dissertation, but, like, without the PhD credit.
Without the 900 pages
of
dissertation.
The same amount of, I mean, they're still pretty long, though. I mean, they're, you know, it depends on your subject, but they can range, and, you know, they're long enough, and you spend the whole year, you get to work with a faculty member on it. So it's kind of the same idea. But that's basically cool. Because of that, unless you were traveling over, like, a break or something, you're not going to be going abroad your senior year. Just, it's not feasible. So most people go their junior year at my school, one of the two semesters. It doesn't really matter. You can definitely go as a sophomore, though. I know some people who want to go for a whole year will go their sophomore year because it's easier that way.
Yeah.
Because you also have to do a junior thesis, which is like a one semester one. So, you know. Usually, if you wanted to do that, you know, you couldn't go your whole junior year.
Yeah. So this is your junior year, right?
Yes. This spring semester of my junior year. And I'm on track to graduate in 4 years, so that's all good.
So what made you pick Ireland? And how broad was the selection at your university? Because I know it can vary by the school you go to.
Yeah. So for me, at least, I was kind of not limited, but my options, the first thing you should do, I should say, if you're going to do this, is talk to your advisor, because, you know, you need to figure out, okay, how is this going to fit in my academic plan and whatnot? And, you know, is this something I could even do at all? And if so, where would be places that would be good for me? So talking to my advisor, he was like, well, basically for English majors, you know, unless you're fluent in another language, you're kind of limited to countries that speak English as their primary language. I mean, again, limited, you know, but basically the options were Ireland, the UK, Australia, or New Zealand. Or I guess Canada, but we don't really have any programs there.
What about South Africa?
There are probably plenty of other examples, but just as far as, like, places are my university has a relationship with.
Okay.
You know, and where people tend to go, those are the options. I mean, that's one thing also to consider, like, you know, a lot of times they'll tell you, oh, you know, you can go anywhere you want. But, like, usually the university has programs that they already have a relationship with. So it's much easier to study abroad through those programs because a lot of the work is done for you.
Okay.
You know, because I know for us, it's like you can petition to study with some other program, but you have to do a lot of the other footwork, you know, yourself, which can be quite extensive in some cases, you know, even just like arranging, you know, for your transcript to be sent, or arranging for just lots of details that could be taken care of if you went with one that your university already
and had. Do you know much about that?
About what?
About the process of petitioning a university that isn't really tied to your current one.
Personally, I do know some people, I think, who have done it. So okay. It's definitely possible. I you know, and if there, I guess if you had a really good reason too, because obviously you're petitioning, so you have to prove it, like why this one and not one of the other perfectly good ones that we already offer.
Yeah. Well, I remember I was hearing about from the study abroad coordinator at Iowa State when I was training to be a cyclone aide, we had to learn about basically every department on campus. So they came in and gave a presentation. And I think I remember them talking about a girl who really wanted to go study in South Korea, but they didn't have a relationship with the university there, so she had to figure it out on her own. So maybe that could be a good follow-up episode if I want to try to find a study abroad coordinator to dig into that stuff.
Yeah, that's true. You should bring one of them on because they know so much. It's ridiculous.
Mm-hmm. But you've got experience.
I even have some people I could recommend, actually, if you want.
Oh, cool. Okay.
So,
That'd be awesome, because I'm sure there's plenty more we could dig into with this topic.
Yeah.
But I think the vast majority of students are going to be able to get something really fulfilling out of the options they have available just with university relationships.
I should say, again, these are my options for my major. Like, I know people who are majoring in biology who they're in, like, you know, Costa Rica or something. I mean, so the language barrier should not necessarily, you know, be a problem if it suits your field in the right way, you know.
Right.
That's something we should also talk about too. Like, I know a lot of people who are in more like STEM sort of majors will be like, oh, I can't study abroad because I have to take this really set curriculum of classes to graduate, mm-hmm. which is true. But I do know a lot of people who have either gone the summer, that's an option, you know, and
oh yeah, yeah,
doesn't always have to be super expensive either. I know some people who've actually gotten funding in some cases. Mm-hmm. Like there was this one girl, actually, she came and talked to one of our class or something. I think she was a biochemistry major, or maybe just chemistry, I can't remember, but she actually got paid to go to France for the summer to do an internship.
Really? So
they paid for her, I think they paid for her airfare, her accommodation, and then they paid her like a stipend on top of that.
Now, was that organized through the study abroad program, or was that?
No, that was not.
Because that's an international internship, which is a whole other topic.
But I should just say there are study abroad ones too. Like, I know some people who went, like, there's a few professors that do a program every couple summers to Siena, you know, in Italy, and that one's like history based, and you get credit for that too. It's not like, you know, a full semester of credit, obviously, but like there's still academic credit, and there's grants for that usually too, that at least make it cheaper. I mean, you know.
Yeah. That's cool. So what made you pick Ireland for yours? Because you had at least a few options.
Yes. Part of it was just talking to the professor, again, my advisor and some others, just about like the quality of the universities themselves.
Mm-hmm.
So it's no disrespect to the ones in Australia and New Zealand, but this professor, having been there, he said like, they're great if you just want to go somewhere and like, you know, hike all the time basically, but like the actual, which is sounds awesome, yeah, but like the actual classes themselves would probably not be, I shouldn't say the same standard, but just they'd be not the same, you know, academic rigor mm-hmm. that I was used to. Again, I don't want to like, and I'm not saying the specific name, so I guess it's fine, but I don't want to like insult them, obviously,
right?
But that was what he said though, so okay, I was like, okay, I'll look at the UK. I had been to England and Scotland before, actually, mm-hmm. in 2007. So I was like 12 or something. So I was, you know, not necessarily ruling those out, but I was like, okay, where haven't I been? So that was kind of what narrowed it to Ireland in general.
Okay.
And then I picked Belfast just because I hadn't really known anyone from my university who had studied here, actually. A lot of English majors at my school do study in Ireland, but they tend to go more to places in the Republic.
Yeah.
Dublin or Cork. Actually, I don't think we can do Dublin for some reason, but Cork, Limerick, there's a lot of others, you know.
Mm-hmm.
So I was just sort of intrigued. I was like, oh, well, Belfast is an option. Why hasn't anyone gone there? And I do feel part of it might be the perception that it's still unsafe here, which is definitely not true. Like, I don't know. do you know about the Troubles? Have you heard of that?
Yeah, I'd heard a little bit about it, but I'd also heard that it's kind of at least, you know, diminished a bit or not a huge issue.
I mean, it's hugely diminished. It's not even anything that, I mean, the worst you'll see now, well, I shouldn't say this because there was actually a bombing a couple weeks ago, like a car bomb, because there's just stuff happens, but it wasn't like, you know, a huge mass shooting or something.
Yeah.
So, I mean, stuff happens anyway. It's not like, I mean, it's just like any other city.
I mean, yeah, I guess you got to take it in stride with events that happen around the world.
But the point is, compared to, like, you know, even 20 years ago,
mm-hmm.
there were actually, you know, like, streets where you could not go because there were literally, like, militias controlling them. You know, it's very safe now is the point.
Mm-hmm.
But I even had professors who would be like, oh, well, be careful. And I'm like, you're thinking of what it was like in, like, the 80s.
Mm-hmm.
Which is fair, but the point is, it's quite safe now, and I guess it's just not on the map in the same way that a lot of Ireland is.
Mm-hmm.
So I was interested. I was like, okay, well, what is this place like? And so I did some research, you know. That was a lot of research, obviously. I didn't just, you know, say, okay, I'm going to Queens, you know. you know, obviously, it's quite easy now, you know, to check out their websites and to... One thing I would also recommend... this isn't true of all study abroad programs, but you could probably find one, at least for the country or city you're interested in, is that a lot of programs, like, students that are on them will keep blogs about their experience.
Oh, yeah.
Which I'm doing, actually, for mine. We can link to that if you want.
Okay.
But those are a great way. I mean, they're not, like, completely unbiased, because, you know, you would hope if they're blogging about it, they're enjoying it. But, like, mm-hmm. they do give you more of a realistic picture than just, like, you know, the university's website, which is always going to make it look perfect, you know.
Yeah, and a blog just gives you more in the trenches perspective, something a little more akin to what you're going to experience.
And there's usually pictures too, you know. Mm-hmm. So that's nice. Again, what it's really like, what the rooms look like, that's pretty easy to figure out. Or
yeah, definitely. I've looked through a lot of study abroad blogs, actually.
Oh, okay. Yeah,
just end up surfing them for random reasons.
And you'll find there's a lot of vloggers too, it seems like. You can
that's true.
You can even go on YouTube and put, like, in, for instance, Queen's University Belfast room tour or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
Actually, I know if that one would work, but I've seen those too, where it's like, this is what the rooms look like, and they'll do a 360 for you or whatever.
Oh, that's cool. Though I do want to say, I think there is something to be said for not doing too much research, maybe.
Oh yeah.
I don't know, and people might disagree with me on this, but when I went to Japan, I did almost no research, and it just felt more like an adventure, because I just had to completely navigate this unfamiliar country with, you know, just doing everything on the fly, and I remember that. Like, I don't know, it was just really cool to do that, so.
I mean... there's no amount of research you can do that will completely prepare you for all the weird things that you'll encounter. So I wouldn't worry a ton about that. But I guess I'd say if you're going to do research, concentrate on the quality of the school itself, mm-hmm. not on, you know, and not necessarily, you know, the rooms or whatever. That's kind of silly. You know, they're fine.
You'll live with the room.
Yeah, exactly.
And then somebody listening to this, like, takes our advice, gets to a school, and it's just like a dungeon.
We keep the students down here.
Cell with a little hole in the floor. Yeah. Who knows?
Lights out at 9 p.m.
God.
And should I say lights? I meant torches.
Actually, here that could mean flashlights. So.
Oh, know. It could. That's true. Is all the dialects the same? Flat torches, all that kind of stuff.
Well, it varies because Ireland. It's like it's the north, but it's still Ireland. I mean, even if people are, you know, kind of some of them, you know, not so. Sold on that idea. A lot of the dialect is it's sort of a mix of like the UK and Ireland.
Mm-hmm.
So everyone says wee. Oh, that's a wee little Czech there, a wee little whatever. It's sort of a diminutive term, but it doesn't matter whether or not the thing is actually small. It's just one of those like filler words, basically.
Yeah, yeah.
I'm trying to think of an English equivalent or American English equivalent. I don't know, but it's the same idea.
Yeah,
yeah. There's and there, but there are definitely some that are unique to the north too. Like, people will say, "Oh, I'm going for a dander." A dander is like a walk, you know, a stroll or whatever.
Okay.
Or, there's some great profanity that is quite unique, and some that isn't even profanity, but just like they'll say, "Oh, you're faffing around."
Yeah.
I mean, you're wasting time. You
know? I use that term sometimes, actually.
Effing around. Oh, really?
That's a Northern Irish term, then?
Or Irish, I guess. Probably more Irish.
Interesting. Irish. I don't use it a lot, but occasionally I'll just throw it in there. So you picked Ireland. Let's go through the process applying, yes, and getting ready to do it. So, I mean, what are the first steps?
Okay, so for mine, I guess I started the process a little over a year ago. I think that would be fair. Well, no, that's not true. I guess it was before that, but like February a year ago, at least, the application to my university was due.
Okay, so almost an entire year before you go, right? Because you've been there since January.
I was researching way before that. I started researching back in, like, you know, at least October of that or whatever. I mean, you could start researching as early as you want, although I wouldn't go too early because the deadlines obviously don't get updated until a certain point. So there's no huge worry. But at least for me, it was like a two-step sort of process. Like, first, you found the program that you wanted, and then you apply through the university that you're at. So my home university, Worcester, you had to just apply to study abroad in general, you know, with them. You had to have a specific program, but like before you could apply to the program itself, Worcester had to approve that. So that was
okay.
That was due.
So step one, you're good to study abroad. Step two, apply to the actual university.
Yeah. I mean, although you do have to like have the place in mind when you complete that application. You can't have five. I mean, it may depend, but like they want, what did they say? Intentionality. That's what they said.
Gotcha.
One of those words. You know, they want to show that you are being deliberate about this, I guess.
Yeah.
And for that, it was like, it wasn't terrible. It was way less than like applying to college. You know, it's just like a short couple essays on just why do you want to study abroad? What do you think you'll get out of this experience? You know, those classic sort of questions. You needed a letter of recommendation. Which I got from my advisor. I think it could be whoever, but just a faculty member who knows you well, basically. And I think just a copy of your transcript and just the usual internal stuff. Make sure that you're in good enough academic standing to study abroad. All that, which hopefully you would be, you know, before you even tried to apply. But they have to ask. So that, I heard that pretty quick from that, I guess. You know, maybe only like a month later. And again, It will vary. You know, you should obviously go talk to your off-campus study or study abroad office, whatever it might be called, at your university. But that was step one. Step two was applying to the actual program. That wasn't actually due until this past October. So fairly late, I thought.
Oh, wow. So it's like two months before you go. Wow, okay. So you basically have to get in and they green light you to study abroad in general.
And then there's this long, at least in my case, this pretty long period of time. I should say this is if you wanted to study abroad in the spring of your junior year. If you wanted to study abroad in the fall, these dates were much earlier.
Because
So there's that to keep in mind. So yeah, they greenlight you. Then there's just this long period of time where you kind of just complete the same process again, honestly, just with the university.
But then it's sent to the next university. And then I'm guessing you wait longer.
A little bit, yeah. I should say, in my case, my college is pretty small. It's like 2,000 students. So we don't actually directly do these study abroad programs, a lot of them. We partner with bigger universities, with bigger programs to send students.
Oh, so is it like Worcester's partnered with University of Tennessee or something?
And it's Arcadia University in this case, okay. In Pennsylvania, and they're actually not a very big school either, but they have a huge study abroad thing. That's just what they do, basically. It's all over the world. So it's Arcadia. I was kind of dealing with them from that point on. And then they are the ones that send all the stuff to Queens. So they're sort of the intermediary. Which was actually quite nice because, again, they take care of a lot of the stuff that you would have to otherwise. You know, they make sure everything gets there, you know, and that everything's communicated correctly. They handle all the money, too, which is nice.
Yeah.
Which we can get to, but for them they wanted the same stuff, you know, your transcripts, and then of course they needed more specific documents, like, you know, eventually you had to have a copy of your passport photo and, you know, that kind of stuff. Be applying for
all those. So that's a good thing we should mention. because I know when I went to go get my passport, which you generally do at the post office, it can take 3 weeks-ish to get it from the time that you go apply and have your photo taken. So yeah, if you're like mapping out deadlines here and you don't have your passport yet, go do that a few weeks before you need to send it.
And especially if you go to college in another state like I do, you really need to map it out because you can't do it. Well, I don't think you can do it in a different state than like your actual state of residence. Mm-hmm. So, you know, I had to like make sure I had it done before the summer was over, basically. And then just had it mailed to where I was.
Wait, are you from a different state than where Wooster is?
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Wooster's in Ohio. I'm from Tennessee.
Okay. For some reason, I thought Wooster was in Tennessee as well.
No. Wooster's in Northeast Ohio.
Gotcha. And
Cleveland is the nearest big city.
Okay, cool.
Yeah. So it's like a 7 or 8 hour drive. So pretty far. And, you know, certainly not something I could just like go down on the weekend to Tennessee to get or whatever.
Yeah. So we've got our application sent to Arcadia, which is partner university.
Yes.
Sometimes it might be just through your own university if it's big enough.
Yeah.
And then,
sure.
So they send it off to
Queens.
Gotcha.
And so from there, again, it was approved, you know, pretty quickly. Again, I was surprised, and it was good to go, basically. So then you get to the real fun, which is all the planning and logistics and stuff. You know, mm-hmm. It's official, I'm going, but now there's a lot of other work to do. One of the first things I had to do was just like tentatively pick classes, which is really weird because basically they're like, okay, here's a link to the online course catalog. And Queens is a huge university. I mean, at least by my, you know, not huge, I guess, but it's big, you know, 27,000 students or something.
Oh, yeah, that's pretty big.
Yeah, they've got, you know, full medical school, law school, all that stuff.
Mm-hmm.
So you're just presented with this giant, you know, online course catalog. Of like, okay, find some classes. They wanted a list of like, you know, 8 to 10, basically, that you might want to take. But they were like, well, we can't really guarantee any of these. It won't really know till you actually get there, so just pick 10 that you think you might like, you know, or whatever. So that's a bit interesting, but you know, it did work out fine. I actually got the ones I wanted. It wasn't a big deal.
Okay.
And it might vary depending upon your major. Like for English, there weren't really any prerequisites. If you were in a more, you know, math or STEM sort of, or STEM includes math, you know what I mean. A more technical kind of subject, there might be like, you know, prerequisite courses or whatever.
Right.
So yeah, you did that. And then mostly from there, it was just like, you know, okay, book your flight, which I would do ASAP if you're going international, because a lot of the wisdom about, you know, the prices, you know, you're not going to snag some great last minute deal on a flight, a transatlantic flight, more than likely.
Yeah.
Unless you have, you know, crazy frequent flyer miles, which maybe your parents do, you know, I don't know.
I think who did it? Some one of those big flight aggregator sites did a bunch of research on this. And for domestic flights, it is generally 2 months to 6 weeks in advance of a flight is generally where you're going to get the best price. Though there's a lot of variance, and it's like it's hard to make a hard and fast rule here.
And
both international flights.
Yeah,
it's true. The time of year is definitely a big factor. You know, if you're going to go skiing or to Hawaii for Christmas, like you probably want to book before you're born or something like that. But for international flights, generally the earlier the better.
Hard and fast. But in this case, too, like there are very specific dates also. So it's not like you can be flexible in the same way that you could, you know.
It's true. Yeah. So you have to be there on a specific day.
I had to get here like about a week and a half before classes actually started, because there's a lot of it's kind of like your freshman year of college, you know, there's like a lot of orientation stuff you have to do.
Yeah. Oh, good question. Since you're going to be there for so long, like 6 months or something like that, or 4 months, did you book a round trip or did you book 2 one-ways?
I booked a round trip.
Okay. So you can do round trip with that much of a gap.
No problem. Actually ended up going through a travel agent, interestingly enough, because we had a bit of a problem looking at it, and I used Skyscanner to find it, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And then the agency I booked it with ended up being not sketchy, but sort of sketchy, at least in terms of their customer service. Like the money was, it's like the amount was on hold, and they're like, oh, we're not really sure. And I was like, this seems kind of fishy.
So sketchy.
Yeah, just sort of fishy. So we ended up not doing that, and then someone my mom knew actually at the school she teaches at, who travels internationally a lot, was like, oh, you should try this travel agent. And it didn't cost us a lot extra. I think she charged us like $20 or something as a fee, which, you know, took a couple $1,000 flight. Doesn't seem that bad.
Yeah, 1%.
Yeah.
Okay, so you got the flight.
Got the flight, all that stuff.
I'm guessing the university kind of, well, actually, I shouldn't assume. Does the university take care of your housing, or do you got to figure that out too?
Yes, but that's not always true. While I've been here, I've been able to talk to other students just across the UK from America. They're all through Arcadia, but different universities.
Mm-hmm.
I talked to someone in London, for instance, where I think they were living in apartments that weren't university owned. They may have been arranged still by the program, I'm not sure, but in my case, yeah, it's just like it's basically the housing that freshmen live in.
Okay.
Because at least over here, and I guess like a lot of, you know, places in the US too, people tend to move off campus after their freshman year, although apparently here it's more like you don't really have much choice, you know.
Yeah.
And it's like super cheap here. Rents are really low. It's strange. So like, you know, it's a lot cheaper not to live in the university housing.
Okay. That was definitely the case for my university as well. And yeah, actually my friend Simon was telling me like after freshman year, you go get a house or something with a bunch of friends.
With friends, yeah. Which is pretty much what everyone does here. There's like a few, you know, student ghettos or whatever, basically, you know, where all the students tend to live.
Yeah, okay. So housing, you might have to take care of it yourself. You might not.
But probably not. I mean, you know, it would depend. I guess if they're charging you some amount that just seems like absurd, then maybe you could be like, hey, could I do this myself? And it would be cheaper, you know.
Yeah. Oh, you know what would probably be a good idea to do is once you've settled on your university, maybe you could just try to get in contact with somebody from that same university who is studying abroad and just ask them like, hey, would it be good to go with the student housing here, or should I try to find my own place? Like, what are the best practices?
And that would just be good for any questions like that too, not just for, you know, housing questions, but if there's any just sort of logistical questions you have, mm-hmm. you could find something else.
Are there any like Facebook groups or anything like that that you use to talk to study abroad students, or is it like an internal chat system?
We have one for our just university that our study abroad set up. It's just like, you know, Worcester students studying abroad or something.
Mm-hmm.
And the study abroad office for us also employs, they call them global envoys, very fancy, but like basically it's just students who've studied abroad from Worcester in the past that, you know, can answer questions. So,
okay.
And there's no guarantee they've done your exact program, but odds are they can at least answer the general questions.
Yeah, they can probably answer some stuff for you. So we've got your housing situation, your flight. In the notes here, you talked about like, we want to talk about how to save money on all the hidden costs of studying abroad.
Yes.
So, I mean, obviously, like, living's probably going to be a big one, but what else comes into the equation?
Food, obviously, is a big one. Mm-hmm. Like, here, the notion of a meal plan just doesn't really exist. There's no such thing. So, we have a kitchen here, basically. There's 12 of us on this floor, and, you know, we're all sharing a kitchen, has, like, two ovens. A little different than in the U.S., different terminology and some different, just they're kind of small, but they work, you know, it's fine, it all works. So food would be a big one. I would say just generally budgeting is a good idea, you know. There's lots of good online calculators that will tell you, okay, here's what the average cost of whatever, you know, food is, mm-hmm. in this city. Belfast is fairly cheap by UK standards, at least. I mean, it still kind of sucks because the pound, obviously, is, you know, much stronger than the dollar.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, you lose a lot in the exchange. So there's one big hidden cost is you might get...
Yeah, that's true.
25% of your money just cut off like that.
Yeah, which is actually what happens, yeah.
And then I'm guessing you can probably walk to school, right?
Yes, it's a 20-minute walk, or they can... They'll rent you a bike too, pretty cheaply, if you really want to do that for some reason. But
I would do that.
Yeah,
If you're going to study in London or something, you might have to pay for the tube every day or something like that.
The tube or the bus. Mm-hmm. Belfast is more the bus system is the big public transit here. It's good. It's a little unpredictable, but it works. cab culture is still pretty big here, but that's expensive. So
is it? Do you guys have Uber or not?
So Uber is here, but it's like not very prevalent.
Okay.
Like if you open up the app, like, I would say most of the times I've opened it, it's been like, all drivers are busy.
Oh, okay. So
like I don't know, but I have a suspicion since there's like five cab companies here and it's a pretty big entrenched thing that they're pretty hostile to Uber, I would imagine, like in a lot of cities, you know, they don't really want it.
Yeah. And, well, have you been hearing about the stuff they're doing in London?
Yeah. Yeah.
It's insane. Like, oh, there has to be a 5-minute wait time before pickup can happen for quote unquote safety reasons. And it's like, no, it's just because the only company that will ever pick you up in less than 5 minutes is Uber.
Yeah, it's the cabs here are good though, to be fair, and they do have apps, so it's not like they're completely in the dark ages. You can you can do most of the same things you could do with Uber, so it's not bad or anything. I mean, again, it's just interesting though, because like people here, a lot of them haven't heard of Uber. Like I was like, I see you guys have Uber. What do people here think about it? They're like, what's Uber?
Really?
Yeah. This is like university students too.
Huh.
Yeah, so cultural thing, I guess.
Yes, it's just more prevalent in America.
But yeah, transportation, I would walk. Belfast is a super walkable city. I mean, again, depends where you are. There are some places maybe you wouldn't be safe to walk. But, you know, I would say generally if you can, do that. Food, you know, I would, in this case, talk to the students and ask them where they shop. Because, like, I know we're here, there's like a lot of, you know, convenience type stores around. But those apparently are a lot more expensive, you know.
Mm-hmm.
Whereas they recommend to me like the local, you know, supermarket, basically. It's called Tesco. It's like sort of like, I don't know what it's like. It's like Aldi sort of, or like Walmart, but small, you know.
So it is like a supermarket there, right? You don't have to go to different stores to get all your stuff?
No. It's a proper supermarket.
Oh, cool.
You know, slash, you know, it's almost like, it's like a small Walmart, I guess.
Gotcha.
Yeah. So that, and the prices there are definitely way cheaper.
So that's, I want to talk about the other, probably one of the biggest hidden costs. It's probably not hidden, but maybe you don't think about it. And that's that most study abroad students that I know take a week or so during the semester to just travel Europe or whatever country they're in, or, you know, just get some traveling done.
Yeah.
So have you done that yet, or is that just coming up for you?
I'll be doing that in the last week, or the first week of April, like the 31st of March to like the 9th of April or something. Yeah.
And where are you going?
I'm going to Amsterdam, Vienna, and Barcelona.
Awesome. Yeah, that's a pretty spread out few cities.
Yeah, so that's one thing I should say as far as like why they're so spread out like that. There seems to, maybe this isn't true, but like, there still seems to be this sort of conventional wisdom like, oh, the cheapest way to see Europe is to get a Eurorail pass or whatever, but that's not really true anymore. Flying is much cheaper.
Really?
Yeah, flying in Europe is like, within Europe, is like ridiculously cheap. Okay. Like as expensive as it is to get here from the US, once you're here, the flights are just absurdly cheap, you know. So I just basically, again, went on Skyscanner and was like, okay, what's the cheapest city I can fly to from Belfast in this range of dates? You know, you can do that on there where you can specify like a whole month or whatever. Again, we can link to this. It's not hard, but you know, you just. So yeah. I was sort of like, I know I want to go in places in Europe. I don't care a ton specifically, you know. There wasn't some city that was like, I have to go here, you know, or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
I was more interested in just seeing a variety of places. So that's kind of how I mapped it out. Just, you know, it's okay. This is the cheapest flight to a place on the continent from Belfast, you know, in this range of dates. Okay. Then I go to that city and be like, okay, what's the cheapest flight from here, you know, after a couple of days. And
so you're just hopping city to city.
I mean, yeah, I mean, I'm spending a couple of days in each, but yeah, basically. Yeah.
Are you flying with Ryanair?
No, actually, in this case, that was not the cheapest. It's EasyJet is mostly it. That's like, okay.
I've heard about that one.
Budget European. Yeah, but them and Ryanair are kind of the two cheap ones.
I've heard jokes
Ryanair
about
has
those.
A lot of flights. Oh yeah, I mean there are.
It's like a bus where you stand
cheap,
up on the plane
they are cheap
or something.
For a reason. They are definitely cheap for a reason, and I will say what everyone else has told me: read the fine print, because again, there are a lot of things they do to make it that cheap that if you're not aware of, you can be dinged with a lot of extra fees. You know, just
you'll be sitting in the duct tape section. That's where we duct taped you to the wing.
Did you see that thing about the sub economy in the U.S., this new thing?
The what?
It's not what it's called, but it's like some airlines are introducing a class like below economy.
Really? I have not heard about that.
Basically, people wanted cheaper flights, and the airlines are like, okay, we can do that, but you know,
it'll it's come a bench.
It's a bench, yeah.
And the seatbelt is you just hold on.
Well, the joke was like they were selling like the toilet, you know, as like a seat.
Oh my gosh, that can't be real.
No, that was
every 5 seconds you have to get up. And
exactly,
listen to
every
music.
5 seconds. But it's super cheap. So yeah, here flying, and this is just seems to be a kind of a universal thing. Talking to other students from the UK as far as how like they travel, you know, to places in Europe too. Air flying is definitely the best way to do it. Mm-hmm. And then accommodation wise too, I will say the conventional wisdom again is hostels are the place to go, and hostels are definitely great.
Airbnb.
Airbnb was cheaper, actually. Yeah. It really was. I was surprised, but
yeah, I found that out in Japan because for the first 2 weeks I was there last time, we did hostels for the first 2 weeks, and I thought it was going to be awesome because the yen was down, but what that ended up doing was it just attracted thousands and thousands of more travelers than usual. So it was so hard to book hostels for more than like one night in a row, and we were just hopping back and forth between hostels every day. We were in Osaka, and I was like, I really want some American food. So we found this Australian cafe close enough, had burgers and pizza and stuff, and the owner, who it was basically Raymundo from Rocket Power, like spitting image of the dude. And he's like, hey, if you guys tried Airbnb, like you can get a really cheap place and basically have an apartment in Tokyo. So that's what we did. And yeah, it was about the exact same price as a hostel. It was about $25 a night for each of us. And we basically had our own little apartment. It was a cracker box, but we didn't have to cart our luggage around to a new place every night. And it was awesome.
Yeah, I mean, because I looked, again, you can go on Hostel World is kind of the one to use, again, for like...
just best name for a band ever.
Yes, awesome. But yeah, in a lot of cases, it was either cheaper or it was about the same. And it's like, if it's the same, I'd kind of rather stay with an actual person who lives there, you know, and get some guidance on what to do and, you know, that kind of stuff.
Mm-hmm.
And a lot of them, too, you'll find are like, and this is probably true in the U.S., but it's like a lot of it's just like other students who just like are trying to like, you know, earn a little extra money toward their rent. Like I know the one I'm staying at in Vienna is like that. It's just, you know, like three, you know, university students there who are like, hey, we need a roommate or whatever for a couple days just to help us pay the rent.
Sweet. That's so, the way to do it.
Mm-hmm.
So you mentioned that your study abroad is cheaper than what it would have costed you to do another semester here in the U.S.
At Worcester, yeah.
So you're essentially saving money by studying abroad. Now, are you saving money even with the flight and everything included?
With the flight and everything included, it's probably breaking even. But okay. It's certainly not like absurdly more expensive, I should say.
Mm-hmm.
And this will depend, again, on what you're doing. But in my case, tuition in the UK is just really low, you know, by American standards. Like people here, it's so funny, you'll see these things. Student protests because tuition is being raised to, you know, from $2,000 to, you know, $2,500 or whatever. And you're like, I wish.
Oh my gosh, yes. When I did the video on like whether or not you should skip a class, I decided to do like, let's do the math to see how much money you're throwing away. Even though it's, you know, sunk cost, it doesn't really apply. I just thought it'd be a fun little equation to do. And I got all these kids in the comments. They were like, oh my gosh, UK tuition, your tuition over here in the UK is so expensive. It's £9,000 per year. And I'm like, that's about the cost of an inexpensive in-state public university here.
Yeah.
Anywhere else, so you're paying way more than that.
And it's actually, well, I know at least for Queens, if you're from Northern Ireland, it's even cheaper. It's like, I think 9,000 is what you pay. It's like the international student rate or whatever.
Really?
You know? No, that's not true. But it's like the UK one, but not Northern Ireland. But if you're from here, it's like, you know, £3,000 or something.
Okay. I heard if you live in Scotland, like if you're from Scotland and you study in Scotland, it's just free. Entirely.
Yeah, that might. I don't know. I've talked to a lot of people about that stuff, and they're like, well, it's not free. It's only like $100 or something. I'm like, okay, so it's free.
Basically free. So you're paying less than you would have paid for a semester's tuition at Worcester, basically.
Yeah, and actually, I had sort of thought this was true, but I was like, I don't know if that's really true. So we pay the money like we normally would, right? And then like we get this email from the business office, and they're like, oh, you know, your account has like a $2,000 credit on it or something. We're like, what? And they're like, oh yeah, this is just extra money that you didn't spend, you know, that would, because it's like, you know, basically you pay Worcester, then they send it to Arcadia, and then Arcadia sends it to Queens. That's kind of the process there.
Okay, so you paid Worcester what you would have paid normally.
Yeah, that is a thing. At least you don't like pay them less, but like in our case, we were like, okay, we'll just keep that money and apply it to next semester, basically, you know.
Okay, so essentially, it was like, hey, look, it's cheap enough that the extra money is gonna pay for your vacation week and the flight, pretty much.
Basically, yeah, that's a good way to look at it, I think, and that would be about right.
It's not a bad deal. So I'm guessing this is gonna be making study abroad cheaper is mainly an arbitrage thing where you want to go to university that costs less than your university. And yes. You're going to a private school, right?
In the US, yes.
Right, yeah. So with your school, it's kind of easy to hit that criteria.
Yeah, that is true. It is more expensive than journals. So for a lot of people, that might not be the case.
Mm-hmm. Well, I was going to ask you, that's one way to do it, but are there like study abroad scholarships you can get that are like specifically for going abroad?
Yeah, I mean, I haven't done a ton of research on this, to be fair, but I definitely looked into it, and just Arcadia that I'm with, they actually just had some scholarships you could get, and I ended up getting one of them without even really realizing I had applied for it. I think it was one of those, it's like, you know, you fill out all these forms, right, and you sort of are just like, okay, I'm doing this, and you kind of forget, and then like a couple months later, like, congratulations, you've won a, you know, scholarship or whatever. I was like, oh, okay, great.
I need a Staples button on my desk.
Where it's just, exactly. It's just like one of those things, I think, where like you just put in your GPA and some other basic information. Like, I don't think it even was like an essay, you know?
Oh, that's awesome.
That was cool. But there are like, you know, other real ones too that require more work, you know?
Okay.
And there are also ones I've noticed that aren't like, not scholarships as such, but like they're things that would help with the costs. Like, one I saw, it's this company called Tortuga, mm-hmm. and they make backpacks. And it's like, you could enter, like, I think you wrote an essay talking about study abroad, and if you like, you know, you could win a backpack or something. But they're nice, and it's something that would be useful to have anyway. So, you know, there's stuff like that, too.
Oh, okay.
That it wouldn't be a direct scholarship, but, like, it would at least help with some of the costs associated with it.
So I imagine just hit up your study abroad office, ask them what's available for scholarships.
And just also all your usual scholarship searching resources too.
Yeah.
Are good places to look.
Yeah, I bet that, you know, I've always said like places like, you know, Zinch and Capex and FastWeb, good places to try applying for a few scholarships in general on, but the competition is so high because all those scholarships are available to everyone. But with study abroad, there are fewer students studying abroad than there are just students trying to get scholarships in general. So maybe your chances are increased a little bit just based on that factor.
Yeah, and also I think that the same wisdom for other scholarships applies too. Like, your university might have like specific study abroad scholarships, you know, endowed by some alum who was like, oh, study abroad is an important thing that students should do, you know.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and my gut says that's going to be probably your best bet.
Yes, definitely, because there's a connection there.
Mm-hmm. Cool.
And a smaller pool.
So the last thing I want to talk about was just generally staying on top of stuff, dealing with homesickness. One question I had is there anything that you've had to deal with back home from abroad that's been like kind of a pain or anything?
Yes, a little bit. Mm-hmm. One caveat people told me from Worcester, at least, about going abroad in the spring is that, at least, you know, it's probably the same as the spring is like when you do your housing for the next year and all this other random, you know, administrative stuff that could be kind of a pain to do from abroad. For us, at least, there are like procedures in place for doing all of that, you know, like forms you can fill out, or like, you know, you can designate someone to be your proxy to act on your behalf.
Mm-hmm.
It's like, and some of this is unique to us because, again, at our university, everyone lives on campus every year. So you have to do the housing process application thing every year.
Yeah.
Not fun. But so there's a form you fill out for that. That's been a little annoying. We also, for senior independent study, you get like assigned a carrel, they're called, like a little desk basically in one of the libraries that you can use for your work, you know, keep all your books and stuff there, and just mm-hmm. So you, again, you have to designate a proxy for that. Just those sort of things.
Okay. What about like dealing with your, like, does your mail get forwarded all the way over to Ireland?
No. In our case, you just tell them you're studying abroad and they basically just, I'm having it forwarded to my home address basically.
Okay. So not, your parents are just taking care of it for you?
Yeah. Well, you just, in our case, you just talk to the campus post office, tell them I'm studying abroad this semester. This is the address I want it forwarded to.
And gotcha.
That's not a huge, and like, it's like you shouldn't be getting a ton of campus mail when you're not actually there, but you know.
Yes,
you probably still will.
But I mean, you'll get other mail and stuff like that, so it's just kind of important to figure out where is that going to go when I'm 2,000 miles away. Can you use your phone while you're there? Because I know in Japan, I had to rent a phone.
You can use your phone if you want to pay like insane amounts for it. I'm not doing that. I have an iPhone. I'm just using that on Wi-Fi just for basic stuff, whatever. And, I just bought like a super cheap phone basically here at Tesco, actually. Just, you can buy them at a lot of stores where it's just like a pay as you go one. Basically all it is just like making calls, you know, essential sort of stuff. A lot of people outside the US also use WhatsApp. I don't know if you've heard of that.
Yeah. I think that's, I don't know if it's on iPhone. It might be.
It is. I have.
Oh, yeah, do you? Okay.
Because we have like a WhatsApp group for our floor here in the dorm, for instance, or like, you know.
Oh, cool.
It's like most people have that, so you know that you can still sort of message people that you might meet here, and my parents have it too, and brother back home, so we can talk.
Okay. Do you just use Skype a lot too then?
I haven't actually Skyped them really, because my parents don't really understand or like use Skype, so they're like, oh, it's so awkward. I'm like, well, yeah, it takes a bit of getting used to, I guess.
Yeah.
And then Facebook Messenger is good too. That works. Even actually, iMessaging works too on Wi-Fi, which I.
Oh, yeah, it's true.
But that still works, so I've gotten a few of those.
Yeah, the last couple times I was in Japan, instead of renting a phone, I just rented one of those 4G hotspot devices, and then I could just use iMessage and whatever I wanted on my iPhone.
Yeah, I'm sure, like, for that amount of time, that probably would work. I don't know how I would do that for a whole semester. I mean, I guess you could weigh the cost and just buy one, maybe, you know?
Yeah, it would have been prohibitively expensive to do a rental for a whole semester. I think it was like $200 for a few weeks. So,
and the one other thing I do want to mention, you mentioned homesickness and that sort of stuff, like, but it's just as far as like making friends and socializing while studying abroad, because you know, it is sort of like being a freshman again. Like, you don't really know anyone. I mean, you might, you know, depending upon your university, know a couple other people. I don't know, I'm the only one here, and it looks like there are other Americans, but as far as like meeting people from the country you're in, which is sort of the point, I would imagine, partially, you know, clubs are a great thing. Like, at least here, I'm eligible to join any club or society that people here would be, basically. So,
okay,
I joined the caving club, which is super cool.
That's so awesome. Just the fact that there's a caving club in general makes me want to go there.
Oh, it's even cooler than that, because we do what's called SRT caving.
Okay, what's that?
Single rope technique, where it's like, you know, you have ropes and harnesses and stuff, and you like,
oh, you're like rappelling into caves
in some cases. Yeah.
Oh my god,
I have
so
not
cool.
done that in actuality yet, but we that's what we kind of our practices, where we have like a, you know, rock climbing wall that we do that stuff on. And going down this weekend actually to it's called Kilty Clahar, which is very western part of Northern Ireland, to do it's for the All Irish Caving Forum, actually. That's what it's called. So we'll be there for like a 4-day weekend, basically, doing caving and stuff.
That's so freaking cool. I love caves so much. Sometimes I'll just like Google and then just kind of despair at how few caves there are around me.
Oh, it's like, it's because what we do basically, it's like, you know how like when you go tour like some cave or something, like a show cave, apparently is what they're called. You know, or basically, it's like, You know the parts of the cave that are like, oh, you can't go over there. That's like what we do. We go over there.
You go to the cool parts.
Yeah. You have to crawl on your... I mean, it's not... It's sort of... People who do it, they're like, it's kind of a, you know, masochistic sort of sport, because it's not really fun while you're doing it, but like, it's cool to say that you've done, you know?
I squeeze myself into a 3-foot tunnel thing.
Scrape myself along rocks and try not to fall into the abyss.
Yay. You know?
Bang my knees up in mud too. A lot of caves are really muddy.
Oh yeah, that's true. It's yeah, true. I don't know how good I would be with like really tight spots.
Oh, you'd be fine. I guess
if they're like, yeah, you're probably not gonna die here. I don't know if I'd be the first person to squeeze into some completely unknown place.
Oh yeah, no.
Pull my feet, I'm stuck. So I think we got a pretty good overview of studying abroad. You think?
I think so. Yeah, I don't think unless there's anything else. I'm not looking at the outline right now, but.
Yeah, well, I mean, if we get questions, I can port those over to whenever I interview a study abroad coordinator because I definitely want to get into more of that. You know, how do I study abroad at any university?
I'll throw you some names from the Arcadia people. That would definitely be useful to you. I think they love talking about this stuff, so I'm sure they would love to go on a college podcast and, you know, proselytize a little bit.
Sweet. So let's just do a quick recap because I know we have a lot of stuff here. So you want to pick your program or at least have a good idea of where you want to go because they're looking for intentionality. Mm-hmm. So, and then I would say in terms of deadlines, just go talk to the study abroad office and then write down a detailed plan of all the dates that are going to be pertinent to whenever you want to study abroad.
Yes. Put them on your calendar. All the usual advice applies here, certainly. Mm. Although you really do not want to miss them because they are very hard deadlines.
Yeah. Ask questions about housing. You're going to want to book your flight pretty early. Skyscanner. I use Kayak. Basically the same thing.
Yeah,
I think
they're all good.
You can set up alerts. So I've actually got like a couple of flight alerts right now, and I'm just getting weekly emails to see like how low is the price gone. That can
same
be helpful.
Too. Mm-hmm. So yeah.
It might be cheaper to study abroad depending on what your school charges for tuition versus what the other school charges, and you can also look into study abroad scholarships. You can look on places like FastWeb, but also look locally where your chances are probably better. And then in terms of making friends, just kind of treat it like your home university and get involved in the exact same ways.
A lot of the same advice applies.
Sweet. Well, dude, thanks so much for coming to the show. And your big trip is coming up in like 10 days. So, man, enjoy Vienna and Amsterdam. And where is it? Barcelona, you said?
Barcelona, yeah.
Awesome, man. Yeah, I'm jealous. I really want to go to Vienna. Like, I want to go to all those places, but Vienna's kind of, I don't know, I just have Austria on the brain right now.
Yes. Listen to some Mozart.
Yeah, exactly. All right, dude. Thanks for being on the show. Awesome. Oh, by the way, I mean, I know you're a writer on the site, but you've got other stuff too. So if people want to find your study abroad blog or any of your writing, like, is there like a centralized place they should connect with you at?
Yeah, my website probably is the best place, ransompatterson.com.
Cool. And I will have that up in the show notes along with your study abroad blog.
All right, awesome.
Cool. See you later, man. All right, guys. Well, that about does it for this episode of the College Info Geek podcast. Hopefully you found it helpful, and hopefully it helps you if you got study abroad plans of your own in the future. Once again, if you want to find all the resource links to the things we talked about in this episode, you can go over to cigpodcast.com and find that episode 101 link on the page. Also, if you want to find my favorite resources for making your college experience generally a better one, go over to collegeinfogeek.com/resources and you'll find all the stuff I have on that page there. That's it for this episode, so thanks for listening, and I will see you in next week's episode. Stay cute.